very often the research that we do ends up leading to more questions, or maybe a better way of saying it is to a deeper question. So we might solve one particular issue, one problem we're looking at in one nucleus, but then the insights we gain, we then can ask, do we see the same pattern somewhere else? Now that we think we understand this, can we apply it to that? I'm Paul Garrett, and I'm a professor of physics here at the University of Guelph. So my undergrad was in engineering at Queen's in Kingston. Following that, I went to McMaster for a master's in health physics and then a PhD in experimental nuclear physics. This was followed by postdocs in Switzerland, in the US. I had a staff position at a laboratory in the US before coming to Guelph as a professor in 2004. So I've been here ever since. So my research is in nuclear structure physics. And the basic thing that we're trying to answer is, how do protons and neutrons, which make up the nucleus, how do they interact and how do they behave together inside of the nucleus? So the picture I like to paint is, you know, imagine you're in the stadium full of fans. And each individual fan in that stadium, as they're watching the football game, the hockey game, whatever they're doing, they can do their own individual random motion. So that would be like an individual proton and neutron. But then, you know, there's the wave that comes. We all love the wave. So that's a very collective thing where all the participants are acting together. And we see this kind of motion in the nucleus as well. And that's the main thing that I'm studying, is this collective motion that involves many particles acting together in order to create. Our research naturally has us making collaborations with people all over the world. Each of us brings a different point of view, a different in-depth knowledge about a particular aspect. And this is what really drives the field forward then, is all of these interactions with the different groups, with different people. The experimental facilities that we use, these involve hundreds of people working to make the accelerators work. So we use particle accelerators in our research, and it involves then this huge team just to make the accelerators work, to keep that infrastructure running. Most of our experiments that we do are at Triumph, which is Canada's accelerator lab. But it's not only there. We've also do experiments in Europe, in Warsaw, in Lignano, in Italy, in Germany, in Grenoble, France, and we've had some experiments in South Africa, in Cape Town. And we've started a collaboration in order to take advantage of some unique facilities in Australia at Canberra. So it involves, you know, large groups of people which come together to focus on some particular question, and then maybe disbanding to go work on another thing. So it's a very fluid type of situation. So rather than only involving a dozen people all the time, we might involve a dozen people in one particular measurement, a different dozen in another measurement, a different, and so on. So it's we form these very wide networks of researchers from around the world. Yeah, so the opportunities that we provide people, and people, I really should say, is the main product of our research. Our graduates go on to work at Chalk River, you know, to address issues that might be related to energy generation or national security issues. There's a lot of our graduates who end up in the field of medical physics, so especially with cancer therapies and so on. But for individual students, we have such a wide breadth of the program that we try to fit individual skills and their interests into the project. So there's some who come with naturally very strong computing background. Then they'll get a more computational style of a project versus others who really want to build something. They want nuts, bolts, pipes, wires, much more mechanical or electrically inclined than they can physically build detectors. And then others who are extraordinarily strong in data analysis and interpretation. And the research projects, because we're involved in so many different collaborations, there's usually a wide variety that we more or less will put on the table. It's like a buffet table, and students can largely choose particular projects that that they can work on. So they take ownership then of a project. And especially at the PhD level, often they're involved in proposing that at a facility, performing the experiment, doing the analysis, and then ultimately writing the publication afterwards. But even our undergraduate students, we also have them leading publications. So I absolutely loved my engineering background, but at some point in you want to move beyond just making something work and not necessarily caring why. I wanted to get at the why, so something just a little bit deeper. And I always had this long-running interest in nuclear physics. One of the reasons I got into engineering was I had a strong interest in nuclear reactors. I thought even when I was a teenager eons ago, at the time of the dinosaurs, that that this was the future of energy generation, would be fission reactors at the time. Now people are talking about fusion reactors being potentially on the horizon. And so my interest was always more coming from that physics or applications of physics background rather than just making a widget work. So it wasn't a big transition to go from a pure engineering into a physical science. What I really like about our program here is the people in our department. They care about students, and that really comes through in almost everything that they do. And because there's that deep level of caring about students, that's a unifying theme for us as a department, and we largely get along, and we're very supportive of each other, which is not always true in academic units. And I think that really then comes through to the students as well, that they know we care about what happens to them and where they're going. One of the big motivations for me to continue to do this research, though, quite honestly, is the impact on people. And I mean that on an individual level. So the actual nature, the product of the research, addressing these questions of the structure of a nucleus, almost becomes irrelevant for society as a whole. But individual people, students who are drawn in to this, the training that they received, we are changing the path and direction of their life.